So we had to talk about vocation. In order to make the point, in order to make it clear, usually we had to go from the beginning to the end. If we do it in the other side up, nothing is clear. So in order to make it clear, let's go to the very beginnings. Let's go to the creation, to the very beginning of the world. When God created everything, when he created men and women, he created us in a very special way, different from all other things. As you may remember in the first book of the Bible, the Genesis, it is written, God said, let us make human beings in our image and after our likeness. So we were created according to God, like God, to the image of God. That makes us to be completely different from all other things, from all other creatures. And what is the thing that makes us different from all other things? It's the spiritual soul. God gave us a spiritual soul that makes us to his image and likeness. So, among the whole creatures, the only one that God entered in a relationship, it was man, humankind. Because God gave us that special dignity, the spiritual soul, so he gave us the soul in order to make us to be able, capable, to enter in a dialogue, in a relationship, in a friendship with him. Why? Because God created us out of love. And that's the only reason why he created us different from all other things. And when he created us, he gave us the soul and gave us a special desire for happiness, to be happy. There is no money on the earth that cannot look after, search for happiness. Every single man. Even the one that is drunk, drinking, the one that wants to commit suicide, is looking for happiness. Not in the good way, not in that place, but it's looking for happiness. This is the most profound, the most deep desire that God gave us and put in our hearts, in our souls. And when God created us, he was not like a machine. He was not creating things in a massive production. You put in the computer, press the button, and you had 100,000 million of babies. He was not doing that. He was very generous in creating us, and he created us different, unique. You can take a look to your neighbor. We are not equal. We are different, completely different, even the appearance. So God created us in a very special way because he loves us, and he loves us personally, in a unique way, in a very particular way. And that desire that he gave us, he put in our soul, the only one that can fill it up is God. God is the only one that can make us completely, fully happy. In the Catechism of the Catholic Church, when you can find all the teaching of the Church, it is written, God who created man out of love, also calls him to love. In order to understand this, what it means vocation. Vocation is call. God is the one that is calling, as the Catechism teaches. God who created man out of love also calls him to love. So you came here to hear about vocation. Usually when you hear the word vocation, what do you think about? Priesthood, religious life, consecrated lay missionary. But that's not true. the vocabulary, the word vocation is even wider. Does everyone has a vocation? Yes. The answer is yes. We have vocation. Every single person has a vocation. So I say God created us unique because he loves us in a unique personal way. And in a very unique personal way, he gave us a perfect, a nice gift, vocation, call. Vocation comes from the Latin and it means to call. He calls us to love him. And that vocation that we receive, the general vocation, there are two vocations, the general vocation that we receive, every single man on earth, is called holiness. We are called for holiness, to become holy, to be happy in heaven, to share with God eternal life. That is the general vocation that every single person has. Special, we receive this vocation in our baptism. The day that we were baptized, that we became Catholics, that same day we became God's children. So we receive a new life, sanctifying grace, the life of God in us. So God is calling us in a very general way to everyone, to holiness, to share in his nature, in by grace, to be happy, to share with him in eternal life. But in order to reach holiness, there are different ways. As we came from all different countries, from different places, from Holland, from Lithuania, from Ireland, from Belgium, from France, from Luxembourg, different ways, different countries. One group came by bus, the other one by airplane, the other one by car, someone maybe walking or by bike. So different countries, different ways to get the point, but everybody is in the same place, the same purpose, the same aim, to be here. So the same, God calls everyone to holiness. We share it with the whole humankind, but God has a particular personal vocation, a call for each one of us. And that vocation is the way how to reach holiness. It's not the same for everybody. God was very generous and very creative. He did not create in a massive production. Each one personal. And for each one has a personal plan, personal purpose, a personal call. So, this particular call, vocation, is called state of life. Why? Different states of life. Consecrated life, priesthood, consecratedly missionary. Because this call configure our whole person, our whole life, in a very specific way. So I told you, it's a very personal vocation, a personal call. And that call configures most in a very special way. Because the vocation, the call, is long life commitment. It's not just one thing for one moment. It's a call that configures our whole life for our whole life. Everything that we are, our thoughts, our works, our elections, personal work, a personal call that configures our whole life and a state of life. So vocation may be marriage. Vocation may be priesthood. Vocation may be a consecrated religious life. There are different calls, different ways, but that way is the only one that I should go to reach the aim, to reach my purpose, the one that God has plan, has thought from the whole eternity. That God created us in a very different way, in a very personal way, and that he has given us a very particular personal vocation, it's a truth that gives us joy. We are not just one out of many. We are one that God knows us by name. That's why he's calling us by name, personally. Eryo, 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 Erash. When we receive that vocation, we receive that vocation since we're, as I told you, since the eternity, since we were in the mind of God. There is already a vocation, but that vocation is something interior, something that is in our hearts, something that God gave us and placed it in our souls, in our hearts. When we have to, so our work is to discover what is inside us, to discover the call of God. It's not something to become a genius, to make up something, to create something new. It's to discover something that already we have in our heart. This is the way of discovering our own personal vocation. It's not something that we elect. It's not a fruit of a test, like a professional test. I go to a special place, to university. They will give me some questions. Say, okay, I have this, I have this, I have this, so I have vocation. I don't have this, I don't have this, this is not for me, I don't have vocation. It's not that way. God is the one that is calling us. So we are not talking about a natural thing. We are talking about something that is supernatural, that is above us. Something that comes from God. It's not something that comes from us. Something that comes from God. God is the one that has the initiative. He's the one that is calling us. And God calls us to a specific mission for which we are created. So call for what? We already know that God is the one that is calling us. This call, this mission, this purpose, this plan is already in our hearts. For what? To do what? To go in a deeper intimacy with God, in a deep friendship with God. Jesus once said, "I have called you friends. It was not you who chose me. It was I who chose you and appointed you." So discovering vocation is not something that we choose. I like this, I choose it. I don't like this, I don't choose it. It's a matter of discovering what God wants from me. To know what is God's plan for me. When Christ went and chose his disciples, it was written in the Gospel of Mark, he went up to the mountain and summoned those who he wanted. So there is a call of love. He called the ones that he loved. And they came to him. He appointed 12 that they may be with him. They called them out of love to be with him. Not just to have fun, not just to share an hour, a couple of days, but to be with him. Not to learn from books, not to go to university, but to be with him, to share his life. So, a call for intimacy, to be with him. This is vocation. So, we are not inventors of something new, but discovering vocation, it is bringing to life something that is already in myself. Discovering, putting to light what is in myself. God's call is interior. So God is not going to send us an angel. He's not going to send a bird to tell us in our ear that we have vocation, that we should become a priest, a sister, or we should marry this guy or that girl. It's not the way. God speaks, but speaks to our heart in an intimacy. It's a choice of love from God. God is the one that is choosing us. It's not you who chose me, but it's I who choose you. He chooses us out of love. And because he's choosing us out of love, we have to give a response. We have to give an answer. Personal, free answer. An answer of love. And since it is an answer, a choice of love, it implies sacrifices. If I have to choose, it means I have many things, and among many things, I have to choose one. Let us put it in this way. I love women, but I cannot have all of them. I have to choose one, because I love this one. I have to choose this one. So I had to make a sacrifice. I had to leave behind some, all of them, just to get one. The same for religious vocation. It's a sacrifice. I had to leave something, but because I chose one, out of love, to give my whole person, to give my whole heart. So how do I discover then the calling of God? How do I understand that God is calling me for this state of life, for that state of life, to become a priest, to become a religious, to become a religious sister, to get married? How do I discover this call? God is not, as I said, is not going to send us an angel. He did in the Bible. For example, the apostle Paul, he was a persecutor. He was against Christians. And how did he convert? How did he understand his calling? Because God gave him a special grace on the way to Damascus, on the way to persecute more Christians. He fell from the horse and he began his conversion. But that's something special. So we should not wait for a special sign that an angel will come, that Mary will appear and will tell me. It's an interior call. So then how do I understand what is God saying to me? In prayer. In prayer, we talk with God. In prayer, we understand God's will in an intimacy with him. God is the one who takes the initiative. Our role, our work is to listen and to give an answer. It's not to create. It's not to do something new. Something that we must discover in our hearts. So then we have to go inside ourselves to discover, to listen. What is God telling us? What is God saying to us? Of course, you can say, as I said, we have the general vocation for holiness. There are different ways to get to holiness. Each one has his own way. This way is already given by God. But in order to get to that point, to get to holiness, in order to understand which way is the one that is that God intended for me, it's not considering, should I become a priest because the priests are closer to God, because it's a more perfect state of life. It's not considering in itself, but it's considering this for me. Is this the way, the best way, the greatest, the fastest way to reach holiness? Considering for me, Is this the way for me? Not in itself. So as I said, the best and the most important thing we have to do is to ask God, what do you want from me? What answer should I give? Once I heard that usually we put computers standby mode, our phones in airplane mode. In order to understand God's call, we had to put ourselves in discernment mode, which means we have to go for some quiet time to be with us, to be with God, in silence, in prayer. So that's why I recommend to do the spiritual exercises, because it creates that atmosphere, that place, special place, special time to understand and to hear the voice of God that is calling us. The most, I can say, not the most, but the first enemy that we had to defeat is fear. When we think about vocation, it's kind of a freaky question. Should I say yes or not? I'm afraid of that, because I understand that it's for something big. It's not just something easy. So it's the first enemy that we have to overcome, fear. We should not fear to say yes to God. We should not fear God. We should love God. Different things, fear and love. St. John Bosco, he says, I think it is a great mistake to say that it is difficult to recognize a vocation. It's not, these are not my words. This is St. John Bosco, a priest, a holy priest. It is a great mistake to say that it is difficult to recognize a vocation. The Lord places us in such circumstances that we only have to respond. He's the one that has the initiative. He's the one that is calling us. He's the one that is showing his will. We only have to say yes. We have to give a response, an answer. Recognizing, these are St. John Bosco words, recognizing a vocation is difficult when one does not want to follow it. This is the problem. When I fear to go and to do what God wants me to do, then it is very difficult. As Father Nicholas was saying today in his homily, we have to see with realism. Not only to see one part of the picture, but to see the other side. Usually when we consider vocation, we think about renounce, self-denial, cross. But take a look to the other place, to the other picture, to the other side. Look at the other side to get a real and exact idea of what it is. What is vocation? What is the way that God intended for me from the whole eternity, so that I may become holy. Once we are discerning this vocation, this calling, when we are considering it, what should I do? Should I say it to everybody? Should I say it just to someone? We have to consider that vocation, the call, is a treasure. A treasure that God entrusted us. So we had to take care of it. We cannot put it in everybody's hands. So in order to discern, we should keep it for us and to open our heart to our spiritual director, to a person that is spiritual, so that understand the spiritual life, to a person that is prudent, to a person that may guide me, help me, because the answer is my answer. It's not my spiritual advisor, the one that had to say if I have vocation or not. It is me who have to say it. I have to give an answer to God. It's a personal, free answer. So the spiritual director, usually when we go for a new place, let's say you have to go to Lithuania, and you want to visit a special place, the Hill of Crosses, how to get there? What will you do? Google Map. Is it or not? So you put the place and gives you indication how to get there. So we have a Google Map. It's our spiritual director, our spiritual advisor. He's the one that is leading us, helping us to reach the point, to understand whether this is a call that comes from God or something that comes from me. It's my own desire, but it is God's plan for me. So I recommend not to open your heart to everybody if you are considering this, the call of God, the vocation, for especially for priesthood, for religious life, but to open your heart to a priest, to a sister, to someone that is, as I said, spiritual and prudent, the one that can guide you, the one that can understand the spiritual life. Once you understood that God is calling you, what to do? Not to run away, not to be frequent. What to do? To say, yes, Lord, even though I'm not deserved it, I'm not ready for this, but you are the one that had the initiative. You are the one that are calling me, so you are the one that are helping me to make it real. You are the one that are helping me during this process of discernment. You are the one that are helping me in order to become a good sister, a good priest, a good monk, a good husband, a good wife. What should I do to respond the call of God, God's call? Promptness. Quickly execute God's will. Do not wait. Do not hesitate, because it's a treasure and you can lose it. Put it in a safe, put it in a safe place. Generosity. God wants a total commitment. He does not want that we give our heart to Him for 5 hours, for a day, for 2 years. He wants our heart for the whole eternity. In order to understand a little bit better, maybe I can give this example. Usually when people get married, they do not say, I will love you for 5 years, and then we consider it. If I like it or not, is it true love? If someone approach you and say, okay, will you marry me for 2 years? What will you say?
No.
No way. Because you are not loving me with true, pure love. In order to give a true, pure answer, we have to commit our whole heart, our whole life. And heroism, to go for that, not to fear, to overcome fear. God is a loving Father. God does not want us to be unhappy. He wants us to be very happy, fully happy. So that's why He has a special way for us. We can go our own ways, but it will be very difficult. We can get lost. We can never get to the point. So better is to listen what God is pointing us, what to do in order to reach that point. Sometimes when we are in this process of discernment, there are some obstacles, difficulties, questions, objections. So I will let Sister Merciful Love to explain some of them, to enlighten a little bit. Sometimes we get in troubles, so she will give us some counsels to understand them in a better way.
Okay, so like Father said, I'm going to talk about different obstacles and challenges, maybe temptations that we can face. specifically when looking at a religious vocation. So some of these are temptations that come from the devil, but some of them might be obstacles that we find maybe from our families, from ourselves, from different different sources. But I just hope to give some light to those. But I'm taking a lot from this little book, Give Me Your Heart. And if you're interested afterwards, I have some copies, so just let me know. Right, so to start off, I want to tell you that the religious vocation is the cross. Right, every vocation has the cross, you know, has its difficulties, and every Christian, we're all called to embrace a cross, you know, to embrace and follow the way of Jesus. But in particular, the religious vocation is a life of constant self-denial and following Jesus more radically in poverty, chastity, and obedience, right? To imitate him and being poor, right? And giving up my own possessions and not having a family and not following my own will in order that he might be my one love. So in order that I can be set apart for wholehearted service for God, if that is attractive to you, that's not natural. What I mean is that's a supernatural desire, okay? So that's a desire that comes from God. Because naturally, we're not attracted to giving up a family, to not having things, right? That's an attraction, like I said, that comes from God. And so that means it must be taken seriously and discerned, right? So now I'm going to begin with the greatest temptation against the vocation. Dun, dun, dun. So the devil knows that a soul who wants to dedicate itself totally to God is lost to him. So he's going to do everything he can to cause trouble and confusion and to do his best to make that soul completely turn away. Or if he can't, he'll do everything he can at least to make them delay. So delay is the biggest temptation against the vocation. Why? Because St. John Bosco said, one who finds an excuse for delaying the vocation once almost assuredly will never solidify the vocation because he will always find new excuses. Ouch. That can sound kind of harsh, but it's not to say that there's not need for discernment. Obviously, we need discernment. That's what Father was just talking about, know the importance. But the temptation here is to take a long time deliberating to make excuses to avoid doing what I know God wants me to do. Right? Like we read in Scripture, it says, keep watching the winds and you will never sow. Keep staring at the clouds and you will never reap. Keep discerning until I'm sure and there's no doubts and on and on and on and I may never enter. Right? Again, discernment is necessary. Which is why the church takes it upon herself to test if a vocation is from God, right? When a person enters a seminary or religious order, it takes years before your final profession. So the order, the seminary, is responsible for testing, is this from God? No, so it's a conversation. Like it's a conversation with your spiritual director, no? But to wait and hold yourself back, to be sure it's from God, that's what can keep someone from entering. And we don't want to echo what St. Augustine said when reflecting on his own delayed response to God. He said, I said to you, I will come now, wait a moment. But now never came, and a moment never ended. Right? And we could say again, but there really is a need to carefully discern, because what if it's a temptation? What if it's coming from myself? How do I know it's from God? Well, if it's a temptation to enter religious life, first of all, it's not likely that the devil would tempt us to total consecration to God. But even if the suggestion to enter religious, if that was even a temptation, the desire can only come from God because it touches a part of our soul that's just for God and us, like an enclosed garden, right? That sincere attraction to follow Jesus more intimately, like that's an attraction that God only can inspire in us. So again, it's not coming from me either because that's beyond our natural inclinations. So if we want to enter religious life to like run away from our problems, that's one thing. Like I went to enter religious life because I get free ice cream in Medjugorje as a sister, which is true. That's one thing. But if I have a sincere attraction to following Jesus on the cross in that way of life, that's something else, and it needs to be discerned. Now, at this point, some of you may be sitting there thinking, oh no, what if I actually have a vocation and a call to this life of constant sacrifice and self-denial, and that sounds really hard, and I don't know if I can do it for the rest of my life, and I'm going to be sad and miserable, and I just want to sit down and eat Chinese food on the couch. So, just to echo what Father said, like, God does not call us to be miserable. Whatever he's calling us to is going to bring us fulfillment and happiness, okay? It's true that religious life is a life of sacrifice. It's called martyrdom on earth. But at the same time, it's also called happiness in heaven, purchased by happiness on earth. Happiness in heaven, purchased by happiness on earth. How can both be true, right? How can it be martyrdom and happiness at the same time? Well, it's because if a person is truly entering religious life to seek Christ and to leave the world, then it's the cross that gives that supreme joy. And the devil may be wanting us to look at all the sacrifices we think we're going to have to make and all the challenges we're going to face and to make us feel like you can't do that. Your whole life? Are you kidding me? Forget about it. But to this temptation, St. Don Bosco told his seminarians, quoting scripture, he said, don't fear that you lack the strength needed for religious life, but have great faith, because God, who started the work in you, will complete it. Right? If God is calling you to something, he's going to give you the strength to do it. So another objection might be, oh, I'm not worthy for that. Right? I'm too big a sinner. I have a past. The truth is, no one is worthy. Right? If priests didn't become priests because they weren't worthy, we wouldn't have any priests in the world. It's not about being worthy. It's about being called, right? Being singled out and chosen by God for this vocation. And also, Jesus has a certain predilection for sinners. Now, who did he spend his time with when he was on earth? Right? We know some of the greatest saints were some of the greatest sinners. St. Augustine, St. Mary Magdalene. Right? He calls the ones who he wants. Or if we feel that we don't have certain qualities that a religious or a priest should have, we need to trust that God's going to give the grace. And he doesn't call the equipped. He equips the called. Right? He doesn't call us perfect. He calls the ones who are imperfect, and he provides the grace that we need. So to move on to a different objection. So many times people might say, well, I don't have a religious vocation because I'm definitely called to marriage. I definitely have a strong inclination to be a mom or a dad. That's natural, and that's really good. And in fact, that desire to give yourself completely to another and to belong entirely to that person, that's essential to a vocation, because the religious belongs entirely to Christ. And it's through that union that they become a spiritual mother or father to souls. So this spiritual maternity and paternity, it's not like just a nice saying, but it's a reality of sacrificial love for the souls that God entrusts to you. No? Another one, so people might say, oh, I can do more good in the world, right? Like if I'm a youth minister or something, or I studied to become a teacher, a nurse, musician. Like I have these loves and these passions and these talents, and I don't think God wants me to throw that away. I think he wants me to use that, right? That could be true if you don't have a vocation to the religious life. Right? It may be that God wants somebody in the world working as a youth minister and to be a saint and to bring souls to him that way, if that's their vocation. But the danger here is using that as an excuse and instead of asking, is this what God is calling me to? Saying, this is what I want God to call me to. Right, and sometimes we find that we give those things up to God, we sacrifice them, because true love means sacrifice. No, it's a beautiful thing to give up beautiful things for love. But sometimes we give those things to God and he gives them right back to us. Right? There's many sisters that studied medicine and are using that in the mission, or that study music and are composing beautiful pieces for the Lord, you know? So But the point is to lay it down first to God and to see what he wants. Okay, the last one I'm going to mention is the difficulties that come from the family. St. Alphonsus Liguori said that the greatest temptation of his life was when he was saying goodbye to his father. His father put his arms around him and hugged him for 3 hours. The greatest temptation of his life. Okay, so the devil, it's said that when he sees he's been cast out of a soul because they've decided to consecrate their life to God, is going to try everything he can to divert them, including tempting them through their families. Right? It's not wrong to love our families. And our families, if they're asking us not to leave and enter a vocation, it's not that they're doing that out of malice. No, it could be out of love. They just want us to stay with them. But that's the thing, no? That for that reason, the family isn't the first ones to consult about the vocation because they're not completely unbiased. Usually, not all the time, but usually they just want the person to stay. But we have to follow God first. Right? Even Jesus had to leave Mary and Joseph and stay in the temple. Right? He made that sacrifice. And he even had to leave his widowed mother to go and begin his public ministry. So Jesus knows the sacrifice that he's asking. Like, he knows what it is. He knows better than anyone. And he's not asking us to do anything that he wouldn't himself do. It's a beautiful thing to give up beautiful things. Right? How beautiful to give up that which we love most in the world, and to make that a gift to God. And it's not that we're abandoning our families. Right? That can be a temptation if maybe our families have financial difficulties or I'm the only child or something like this. But if God is asking a sacrifice from a family, he's going to compensate. God will not be outdone in generosity. If a family is generous in giving a son or a daughter, it's said that Jesus Christ himself replaces them in the family, meaning that he's going to give graces that that family otherwise wouldn't have had if that person hadn't left to follow Christ. So whatever it is, whatever the concern is, it's about trusting in divine providence, that God is going to take care. Right? So God has a plan for us, whatever it is. It's a plan for great joy. And our enemies want to steal that from us. But in the words of Father Willie Doyle, an Irish Jesuit, a martyr of charity, he said, "Follow God trustfully and bravely, and you won't regret it."
To sum up, like a conclusion, we have a purpose. We have a plan. God has a plan for us. So we have to consider this. The one that is calling us is God, our Creator, our Redeemer, our Father. It's not someone that we do not know, but the one that we should know. And he is calling us out of love. There are two vocations stories. Bell is running. Very quick. The apostles' vocation. Christ was the one that approached them and called them, "Follow me." Right away, they left behind everything and followed him. And they are now holy people. There is another story, another vocation story in the Bible. A young man, very special one. He wants to be happy. And he approached Jesus. He went to Jesus and says, "What must I do to inherit eternal life?" Which means, what should I do to be happy? And Jesus says, "Fulfill the commandments. Love God. Love your mom. Do good." And he says, "Master, I've been doing this for many years, but I'm looking for something more." He felt a desire for something bigger, for something novel, for something special. So once again, what should I do to be happy? So it is written in the gospel. Jesus looking at him, imagine this scene, this moment. Jesus looking at him, eyes to eyes, loved him and said to him, "You are lacking in one thing. Go, sell what you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. And then come and follow me." So he went, asked, "God, what do you want from me? I'm ready to do it." So when Jesus actually gave the answer, said, "Come and follow me, leave behind everything that you have," the Bible says, at that statement, his face fell, and he went away sad. He was not looking to do God's will. He was looking to do his own will. That's why he went away sad. He was not happy. So in order to be happy, we have to say, "Yes, Lord," to his will. So then we will be happy. So matter is to discover what God wants from me, not what I want from God. I'm not the one that I'm had to tell God, "This is the way I will go for holiness." It's listening what God wants for me in order that I may be happy. So the last quotation, Jesus says, "If anyone will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever would save his life will lose it. But whoever lost his life for my sake will find it." So consider the vocation. Do not fear the cross. Do not fear the cross. Jesus is calling you to share his life with you. So give a generous, heroic answer. Thank you very much.